At Drummond Golf, we understand your passion.
Nice roll.
And that's because every Drummond Golf store is owned and run by a local who loves the game as much as you do.
Yeah, it's come off the face really well.
Someone who knows where you play and what you need.
Oh yeah, looking good.
With Australia's biggest range and expert knowledge.
Great. Now let's try that putter with this grip.
So if you want to improve your game, see your local expert at Drummond Golf.
I've never seen anything like it before, and to attempt to hit the ball out of there is pure madness.
The winner of the gold medal and the champion golfer of the year is Cameron Smith.
This is the one that I've always wanted to win since I was a little kid, so it just feels pretty amazing to be able to get it done today.
It's amazing that it's my destiny to be the first Aussie to win. Just incredible.
Hello and welcome to the Playing from the Tips AIG Women's Open Preview episode, also known as episode 77 of Golf Australia Magazine's weekly podcast covering all things professional golf around the world. Jimmy Emanuel here in the host chair, as the Old Course is our primary destination this week for the final major of 2024, while we also check in on the FedEx Cup playoffs and the BMW Championship, as well as the DP World Tour's Danish Golf Championship. Joining me to do that, firstly, is just like the Old Course in the Open Rotors, a steady, regular and comfortable stop, perhaps unappreciated for its commonality. That's Rod Morey, of course. Rod, welcome.
Jimmy, that's the highest compliment you can pay me. I have a mate that I worked with very early in my newspaper career, and his father was a photographer at the same paper. He had a saying, in life, you want to be two back and one off the rail. Don't attract any attention, unlikely to win, never going to finish last and end up at the knackery. That's where you want to live your life, and I think that's what you've just described, so thank you.
I think probably a little higher than that, but that's okay. And yet again, Adrian Logue is somewhere other than on this podcast. It's almost like he's not committed, unwilling to dial in. And combine that with the fact that we got a much better option as our third so-called expert. We welcome to this show for the first time, and our so-called expert crew, editor of Women and Golf magazine in the UK, on site at St Andrews, sitting in the media centre on her own. It's Emma Ballard. Emma, welcome.
Hello, thank you for having me. I'm very excited to be on this podcast.
I believe you even sometimes listen to this show, so there must be something a little bit wrong with you. So,
I'm like a regular. I've had to move over since my favourite podcast doesn't seem to be produced anymore, Rod. So I'm having to, you know, find other ways of listening to you guys. So yeah, I'm a regular listener, and also I feel that maybe I'm here because of my slight bantering slash maybe trolling on Twitter to some of your previous episodes and predictions. So I'm really hoping that the women here aren't going to not speak to me after my pick this week.
Not sure exactly right. After publicly shaming us for tipping people who then miss cuts or play poorly, we thought we'd give Emma its turn. So this is her chance. As we like to do each week, we go through last week before we get started into the new stuff and highlights, lowlights, anything in particular. Mine, I think, it's hard to go past Lauren Coghlan, who won in Scotland, a grinder of an LPGA Tour player. You don't get grinders in men's golf so much anymore, and that was just so cool to watch.
Yeah, the grinders.
It was brilliant. I mean, I was going to say I didn't quite make the trip just to see her do that, but because of the Women's Open being in St Andrews, it seemed like a really good opportunity to actually be on the ground and watch the final day. So got up really early yesterday morning and headed up to see the final round play out. And I don't know, obviously you can watch it on the TV, but when you watch her in live right in front of you, it was fantastic. And just, you know, it wasn't like it was easy. There was trouble. She was in bunkers and she was just getting out. And as I think it was like 7-1 putts the last seven holes or something. It's just fantastic to see. But my little claim to fame is, and I'm not really good at just having a chat with people around me. I'm not that sort of person, but I did notice her husband standing behind the 14th. It was the 14th tee, and I thought, you know what, you're going to have to ask him. So I said, you know, what's worse, if you don't mind me asking, what's worse, you know, being a spectator or being on the bag in this situation? And he said it was definitely much worse being a spectator, which I thought was probably the answer I was expecting. But I think, it's much worse him not having any control over what was happening. But yeah, she played so well.
I once walked around as Hannah Green won a Vic Open with her now husband, Jared Felton, who's a tour winner himself. And you would have thought a man who's played a lot of tournament golf and won quite a few tournaments, when he was the most nervous, embarrassed. Like, it was ridiculous to watch. He couldn't watch her hit shots. He was that antsy. It was unbelievable. I think when they take the control out of it, they lose their minds, really.
Yeah. Yeah, it was, as I say, it was just watching him. He just looked terrified the whole time. But no, yeah, that was really good to see. And I know, obviously, it's great to see the same venue being used as well at Dundonald. And I think they're going back there next year as well. So with a new sponsor with ISPS Handa. So it's been, yeah, really well received. And obviously not too far for them to travel over to St Andrews.
Yeah. Jimmy, it's a good story, Lauren Coughlin, and a great time in the calendar, the golf calendar, for her to be doing it, getting eyeballs to the women's golf when they're about to play at St Andrews, having just played Dundonald Links. Great ad for the game, I think. Interesting golf on interesting courses. Anybody who that story appeals to, switches on the golf for the first time or not a regular watcher, they'll see something that they don't see week to week, none of us see in professional golf, and that's really good stuff. So, yes, great stuff having Lauren Coughlin. What a story, Jimmy. How many years on professional golf before she goes bang, two in a row virtually?
Yeah.
Extraordinary.
There were some other good stories as well. Hideki winning with a fill-in caddy because he got robbed with his entourage on the way back from the Open, and his caddy lost his passport, had to go back to Japan. That's not a bad yarn if you're riding golf.
Yeah,
it's pretty interesting.
Overscripted, Jimmy. Don't present that to me again. Nobody's going to buy that plot. You can try again. Yeah, amazing, isn't
it? All right. I reckon the normal caddy might not buy that plot because he's going to struggle to get his job back.
Well, not only that, Jimmy, you missed out on a fairly sizable check.
It was pretty handy money too, yeah.
Yeah, a percentage of what Hideki took home last Sunday would have been very nice, thank you very much. So, yes, yep. I'm sure there'll be negotiations. I think the guy that caddied for him is an LPGA caddy, is that right,
Jimmy? Yeah, I believe so. And then you had Brooks and John Rahm going head-to-head for the first time in LIV, which actually was really interesting to watch. You know, two of the best players in the world, two of the best to watch. And then on our home tour, and I don't know if you've clocked any of the PNG Open in Papua New Guinea, which is our first event, National Open. So we had on the first day, there's a local amateur collection that gets to start. The Prime Minister of Papua New Guinea was playing. He then had to withdraw in the morning. The first reserve, Connor McDade, who's the son of a teaching pro, Dennis McDade, gets in and was tied for the lead after the first round. So had everything that only a small National Open could have.
Yep.
It was outstanding.
Yeah, that sounds fantastic.
Nothing like a diplomatic incident dipping into the results, do you think?
Yeah, I'm not going to go into any of the depths of what happened as to why. I don't know, but yes, very interesting. On last week, we had a fairly quiet week of our own, but we did manage to scrape away with three top 10s. Takes us to 110 for the year. That's with 17 victories. Of course, Rod, those are unbeatable numbers in weekly golf preview podcasts recorded on Tuesday mornings in Australia.
And occasionally featuring the editor of Women in Golf magazine.
That's true. Well, that's a new one. That's good. I like that.
Jimmy, you say we've had this and we've had that and we didn't do very well. Really, the problem's with the players, isn't it? They're the ones who aren't performing when we've picked them. So let's just put the
blame group
along.
That's
true.
Thank
you. Just to clear that up. Golfers beware.
Nice. On to this week and the AIG Women's Open, which has arguably come along further or developed more than any other major championship, I think, in recent years. Emma, you're there. What's the feeling like at this event? Is it noticeably improved in the times you've been there? What's the vibe like at AIG Women's Open?
Well, it's a bit difficult to tell completely because obviously we're sort of day one and I haven't had a chance of being in the media centre a bit too much. I'm hoping to have a proper look around tomorrow. But the hype around it is quite impressive. You know, we have been talking a while about this one. This is meant to be, you know, if you've been to an Open here before, come and see the Women's Open. It's sort of the way it's been sold to a lot of the local sort of public. I don't want to be hypercritical, but sometimes I think it's not come as far as I would want it to. I feel like we should have more spectators than we're going to probably have this week. You know, obviously last year we were closer to London, so that was a bit more appealing, I guess, a bit easier to get to. So it's difficult. The RNA do keep things close to their chest, so it's difficult to know sort of what we're going to see until we actually see people on the ground. But, you know, there's no way that we can say that the RNA haven't tried to make this something different, something special. You know, the whole fan experiences at the center of this. Obviously, the players are really important, but the fan experiences is really key. And they're trying to attract a different audience, which in my mind is really, really hard to do. You know, we're not trying to go for your normal golf fan that you would normally see walking around the Open or one of the other sort of men's championships. We're trying to attract a new audience. Well, that's what the RNA are trying to do. And I think that's tough. So yeah, I mean, it's going to be a fantastic week. The weather's looking a bit dodgy, which is always fun. And we've got, as they say, a world-class field. So, you know, it's going to be, yeah, exciting to watch.
You mentioned it's obviously a special thing to go along because it's the old course at St Andrews. Only the third time that this has held this event. I think everyone in golf knows about it. Anyone who's got more than a passing interest in the game is familiar with it. But, Rod, tell us a little bit more about the golf course and particularly this week.
Well, funny enough, the golf course is a bit like the bunkers on it, Jimmy, where its catchment pool is much bigger than its physical footprint. And I'm sure Emma will attest to this and anybody who's been to St Andrews. The whole town is kind of special. If you're a golfer, it infects every part of St Andrews, from the people who are serving you in shops to the cabbie to anybody who's around the place. If they don't play golf, they'll have some knowledge of golf because of where they live. And so I think that as an experience – it's the best thing I've ever done. I played the old course back in 1997 and it was really special. So the course itself will be even more so star of the show this week than what we tend to see, and that's great. I can't think of anything better. It's a special week on the golf calendar when you've got an Open Championship at the old course. You just don't ever see golf like it anywhere else. So we won't go through the history of it, Jimmy, because it's been around a while. But I really like this quote from Bobby Jones. I think it sums up what I was just talking about. I could take out of my life everything except my experience at St Andrews, and I would still have had a rich and full life. That's pretty high praise, isn't it? It gives you the feeling it's not just the golf course, and it's about sort of the whole town. The course itself, well, everything that could be written about it probably has been beguiling, puzzling, unfair, incredibly interesting, wrinkled, crumpled. Apart from the fact that you're playing at the old course, which is for most of us enough to try and get over, everything there, everything on the ground of the old course forces you to think about every single shot. The players in this week's field will not have seen anything like it often, if at all. They'll never have seen fairways so wide. It's 130 yards wide, the first fairway, because it's joined with the 18th, obviously. It's an unthinkable thing. So there's a shock value for a lot of players, I would think, coming from the old PGA who've never played any links golf or have only played limited. It'll be a real sort of shock to them. But the old course always turns it on. What'll be really interesting partly this week, we watched the men here just a couple of years ago when Cam Smith obviously won. We always talk about distance in the game and whatnot. I couldn't find the actual yardages for each hole. So I don't know if they're using any of the off-course tees that they use for the men's championship. I doubt it. It's about 600 yards shorter playing this week. But it'll be fabulous to see the course played with a different set of skills to what we've seen the last three or four times it's been at St Andrews from the men. It's a lot less bomb and gouge, which is not to say that the women hit it short. They hit it plenty long and they're good players. But they hit it more like the distances we used to see from the men in the 80s and 90s. So in that sense, if you've got any interest in architecture and how it relates to the game and the professional game, this is going to be a really sort of interesting test. Though, of course, the old course's defense isn't length. It's wind. Generally. So, Emma, what's the forecast like? Because the more wind, the more interesting the golf gets for us as spectators and the trickier it gets for the players. What's the forecast like? What's it been like since you've been there today?
It's been relatively calm today, to be honest. But looking ahead at the forecast, Thursday's looking pretty tragic. But again, I'm not quite sure. Obviously, things can still change between now and then, but they're sort of saying 20, 25 mile an hour winds on Thursday plus rain. I just don't think the morning starters are going to get a really good look if that's how it stays. And then it seems to be settling a little bit more over the next 3 days after that. But I mean, that if you know, we've seen it in previous majors. If you have a scorecard record on the first day, that could be it for you. I do actually have the scorecard here, and I have to say that I'm not very good at remembering the distances of any championships, but it's going to be set up for 6,784 yards or 6,203 meters.
How long is the 17th playing on the? As long as the
17th, they have got it down as 439 yards.
So it's playing from the actual 17th tee.
That's the actual 17th tee. Yeah,
which is fabulous. Yeah. And I think anybody who's played the course as a recreational player should have a particular interest this week because it'll be really interesting to see. I mean, the top women players hit it close to the what sort of better amateur golfers hit it in terms of distances. So you'll see something somewhat similar, obviously a different. It's
just, I mean, it's so different when you watch them play up close than when you see them on the TV. I mean, look, some of the players and their stature is so small and they're just like generating unbelievable clubhead speed and the ball is going an absolute mile. So you're bound to be impressed if you're here to watch it.
It's the
same. Can we just make a note of the impressiveness of the players? I agree with all that, but the impressiveness of someone actually doing some research and having a scorecard on this show?
Yes, that's exactly right. Well,
that's not what we do here, Emma.
To be fair, it's the only thing I did have was a scorecard. I don't know much else, but I did have a scorecard.
excellent stuff. Look, so as I said, it's going to be fascinating golf to watch. Holes to watch, this is stuff at the old course because they're all fantastic. One that probably often gets overlooked, but I think it'll be really interesting this week as well, particularly given that the women don't carry the ball as far in there as the men do. The 12th hole, the short par 4. What yardage is that playing to, Emma? I read that it would be probably within range, particularly of some of the longer hitters, but it's got 5 hidden bunkers from the tee that you can't see. You've got to drive it to a sort of a point in space and hope that it doesn't end up on there, or you've got to have a crack at the green. No matter what happens, there's diabolical second shots coming up all over the place. So will we see them going for it? What's the yardage playing there, Emma?
So on the 12th, it's 351.
Mm. So depending on the wind, it's probably out of reach for most. But there might be some we'll have a go. But there's always interesting stuff to see around the green there because there's so much trouble to be had. So that for mine is one that I'll be looking at watching. But the 17th hole, of course, probably the most famous and architecturally one of the most interesting holes in the world, alongside the 13th at Augusta National. You can't get a better golf hole than the 17th at St Andrews. All of the questions that it asks and all of the possible ramifications that it throws up for both good and bad shots, and where it comes in the round and the tournament is fantastic, because unless the lead is genuinely insurmountable, it's not over till it's over at an open at the old course, and the 17th will likely have something. If I recall, the last time the women played here, Stacey Lewis won, did she not hit one of the all-time great hooking 5-irons into the 17th on Sunday?
Correct.
A shot that was so good and so perfect and so memorable that it's the one thing I clearly remember from that women's open. So, look, I think, again, Jimmy, the course will be absolutely one of the stars of the show this week, and the players have got a great stage to show off some amazing skills. We're going to see some fabulous golf, I'm sure of that.
I did see that Grace Kim went down to where Cam Smith hit his putt from on 17, that around the bunker that everyone always very excited, and putted it straight in the bunker this morning. So that was, I reckon, try and not leave it there during the event, I reckon.
I reckon, Jimmy, there'd be a divot down there the size of a small dog from everyone who's lined up since that day in 2022 to have a crack at that shot and explain to Cam Smith why he should have hit a 60-degree wedge as they blade it into the houses on the other side of the road.
Exactly. when it comes to the field, it's pretty much every player is a player to watch. It's a major championship, so everyone's got a chance. And a particular Lynx golf, particularly like the wind that Emma mentioned, it's one of those things where anything can happen. And as Rod talked about, you've got a course that's much more sort of in the balance of players might get some luck and make up shots on the field, and others might hit in one of those hidden bunkers and go backwards. So there's a lot of players to watch, but you've got Lydia Ko fresh off a gold medal, Nelly Korda getting her game sort of back in order after a run of missed cuts, defending champion Lilia Vu won not long ago, Ayaka Fure won the last major, Lauren Coghlan we've already mentioned, Charlie Hull had a good week last week, and this just feels like an event she's made for. I think we talk about Charlie Hull on this podcast every single week. But I think this week particularly, Esther Henselite is really coming along, obviously medaled in Paris as well. And there's the likes of Celine Boutier, Yuka Sasso. There's just so many good players. So picking out one who's going to be the standout, and of course there's Aussies that we'll get to very shortly as well. Picking one who's a standout is difficult, but that's what we do here. So, Emma, make your debut tip of who is going to win the AIG Women's Open, please.
Well, I didn't want to have to go first. So this is not done as sort of retribution to some of your picks in the past, I promise.
This is going to be good.
But I am going to go for an Australian, and I am going to go, and I know I'm hoping I can tip an Australian, but I'm going to go for Minji, because in my research, which I have done, to be honest, she's just a, she's, I'm not, As you said, there are so many that could win this week. So I actually don't know that I could actually predict the winner, but she's certainly going to be in the mix. You know, she's got really good form at Women's Opens on links courses is basically where my prediction has come from. You know, in Troon in 2020, she finished third. In Carnoustie, she was tied fourth. In Muirfield, she was tied fifth. And then last year, at a non-links course, she finished tied 50th. So even if you go a little bit back a little bit further, she also finished 10th at Royal Itham and St Anne's back in 2018. So, you know, she had not maybe the best final round yesterday at the Women's Scottish, but again, she was in the mix. She's always in the mix. It feels like it's coming. And I know you've said it many weeks in a row that it sort of feels like it's coming. So yeah, I'm going to, that would be my prediction, because of all the people that you've mentioned, I feel like she's the one that potentially has the one to get it across the line. If and with last week's experience as well with the wind, I think that's going to help. I think that will help her more than, say, Nelly, who obviously is a fantastic player. I do think that anyone that played last week maybe have that edge, because it really was grim on a couple of days in Dundonald's. So they've had a bit of a test already.
Yeah, good warm up.
I'm sorry for saying an Australian. I'm not
going to keep
Australian.
It's okay. Not at all. Interesting, Jimmy. There's probably some similarities between, and I think Emma's right, Minji Lee seems a great fit for Lynx Golf. Pine Needles, where she won the US Women's Open, not that dissimilar to what we're going to see this week. Lots of width, lots of ground shots. She's got terrific imagination around the greens. She's like a machine. She hits it so good, fairways, greens. When she misses, she chips it good. I agree. And I think, like all of these players, these big events light a fire under the best players, and she's one who has a fire. We talk about Hannah Green a lot. I think that happens with her. She has a fire lit under her, and yeah, I like that pick, Emma.
I think Minji's an underrated wind player as well. Like, she grew up playing in Fremantle where it is windy. She's such a good ball striker and performs so well in, you know, glue golf test where you got to just fly it to a certain number, that she doesn't get rated as highly for a win play as she should. So I think that's a very solid pick. Rod, who are you going to go with as your winner?
Well, I'm a newspaper hack at heart, Jimmy, so I like to cheer for the story, and I can't help but think there'd be a better one than Lydia. I wonder if we're on the verge of seeing Lydia 2.0, which will be spectacular and short-lived. I wonder, everyone's asked her about retirement, obviously, since the Olympics, because she said a couple of years ago that, you know, she'd be retired by 30 and whatnot. I got the sense that she'd sort of been thinking about this. She's still keen on the idea of retiring early, but she hasn't quite done enough yet. Two majors seems underachieving for her in a way. Her career deserves more than that. She's achieved so much in the game. I think it'd be an amazing story if she managed to get a bit. There's no question that she's got the game. She's got the imagination. I followed her around Royal Melbourne when she won the Australian Open here with Clates, and it was just a clinic. She's got vision like Minji Lee has for where to hit it and the ability to hit it there. So I think she'd be right in there. I think that'd be a terrific story.
Yeah, I mean, and watching her yesterday, it really, the only thing that stopped her being better was where the putts were just not dropping. From what I could see, everything was just coming a bit short or not quite going, you know. So, again, that story of the Olympics, I was just, like, so excited to see her win. I mean, it was so fantastic. And I liked, like, her reference to Simone Biles and, you know, you write your own ending and stuff. And that inspired her to then do it, you know. So she could have had the win earlier on in the year to get that final point for the LPGA Hall of Fame, but now actually she did it in much bigger style, which was fantastic.
A win at the Old Course would sit very comfortably on Lydia Ko's resume. Yes. A great spin at the Old Course, and she absolutely fits the bill, I think. So, yeah, go Lydia. It would be great to see.
Absolutely. I mentioned her in the players to watch, but I'm going to go with Charlie Hull yet again. Sorry, Emma, but she was fifth last week.
So there's one Australian out of it and one English out of it.
Yeah, so it's a trade. fifth last week, second in this event last year. She actually doesn't – I mentioned she's almost seems suited to this event. She doesn't actually have that good of a record in this event, but another one who wind and all that sort of stuff it kind of switches Charlie on. I'm such a fan of how she plays golf, and I just think form coming in, everything going, it's just she's had a big year attention-wise but also played well, so I think Charlie is a huge chance to go well this week.
I was just going to add in that I thought that some of them, she was playing yesterday with Minji and Lydia, and I said to Rob before we came on that I think she struggled a little bit with the pace of play yesterday, actually. I think if she'd been in a different group, actually her score would probably been better. It was quite slow, and I think that doesn't really appeal to her. So hopefully if she gets some good pairings this week, I think that will also help her chances too.
Absolutely. We've mentioned Minji amongst the Aussies. She is one of a handful of players who are in Scotland and trying to win the Open. That would be Hannah Green, Grace Kim, Steph Kiriakou, Minji Lee, Hira Navid, and Gabby Ruffles. While certainly the opposite of last and least, Kari Webb. So Kari's going to pick it up this week, a three-time winner of this event, chance to play the old course and a major. It's everything, you know, Kari wants to do and has the right to do at this stage in her career. So Kari and Karen Lunn and Corinne Dibner are the Aussie champions here, and we've got that group trying to follow in their example. I'm going to say that, Emma, your top Australian pick, even though you're not an Australian, is probably going to be Minji, given you're going to think she's going to win. So
I know, but I do like Hannah as well. After what she, after again, gutted for her with her Olympics. But yeah, but obviously Minji.
Yeah, Hannah was so good at the Olympics. Kiriakou so good at Evian. Minji, we've spoken about. Gabby and Grace just continue to impress. So Rod, who do you think is going to be the best of the Aussies?
Well, this could go either way, this tip. I like Steph Kiriakou. She got a taste of big-time golf at the very top of the leaderboard for the first time in her career there. I reckon, A, she would have learned a lot, but B, I think she'd be one of those who gets a bit hooked on that, and I wouldn't be at all surprised to see her again this week. Who knows whether the golf course will suit her or not. It is the sort of golf course where players who you think would love it hate it, and players you think wouldn't like it love it, so you can never really tell. But if she's one who falls in love with the old course, I mean, we know how good she is. We know how low she can go. She's a real birdie machine. And look at an old course, and particularly one in an open where the draw can have an effect. If she gets the good draw, posts a couple of good scores, who knows? But she's a great personality too, Steph. It'd be great to see her do well again. But she'll be my pick among the Australians.
I also had Steph as a short list because she's actually played really well in this event too, whenever it goes to a Lynx golf course as well. And when it's windy, she grew up at St. Michael's Golf Club, exactly, which is windswept every day of the week. But I'm going to go with, as John Huggan likes to say, Scotland's Hannah Green as my top Aussie, because Greeny obviously played well at the Olympics, but added little uptick for Hannah, inside knowledge here. Her close friend and two-time winning caddy, Monica Marchesani, social media guru for Australian golf, is in town. She worked last week at the Scottish Open with the LET. And whenever Mon's nearby Hannah, Hannah plays good.
Okay.
You know the feeling when your mate's golf ball flies past yours? Or when you're on the green in regulation, but he holds it from the bunker? At Drummond Golf, we get it. That's why we have our lowest price guarantee. As Australia's biggest, you can count on our massive buying power for the lowest prices in golf. But if you do happen to find a lower advertised price, we'll beat it. The Drummond Golf Lowest Price Guarantee. Unbeatable. Conditions apply.
To wrap things up in terms of Scotland, we all need to pick an outside chance to potentially get a win. Rod, do you want to lead us off?
Outside might be a bit of a stretch, but not many people will talk about it. But I tell you who does lift for the big events, and that's Ali Ewing. She constantly impresses in big tournaments. Great performer in the Solheim Cup from memory. And I think this week again, who knows? She's a terrific ball striker, really good golfer. Whether the course will suit her, she would have seen very little of things that look like St Andrews, I'd imagine, in her career, except maybe the odd time when she's travelled to play the Open. Not a lot of golf that looks like St Andrews where Ali Ewing comes from. But, yeah, she's impressed me at every one of the last few majors. She hasn't been right near the top, but she's been solid and around. So Ali Ewing is an outsider.
Nice. Emma, an outside chance from you?
Yeah, well, obviously not going to say that Lauren Coughlan's an outsider, so she's not going to be my pick, but I do feel that she needs a mention amongst us all. But to go back to back would be pretty impressive, but I don't think that people know her so well. So that could have been it, but I'm actually going to go down the Swedish route because I feel like I could pretty much pick any of the Swedes in the field and they potentially have an outside chance. But I'm actually going to go with Madeline Sagstrom. I've got a feeling that, you know, again, she's got some good form on Lynx Golf. You know, she's been playing pretty well this season. You know, she came really close to a win. And, you know, there's Solheim Cup and all sorts of things in the mix as well this week, which again, might buoy up some of the Europeans in particular to put on a good show. So, yeah, I'm going to go with Madeline Sagstrom.
The beauty of this show, is, Emma, that given I'm in charge, I can decide who is an outsider and who isn't. So I probably would have given you Lauren Coughlin, but
okay.
And also because my outsider is maybe the more ridiculous outsider pick. But again, because no one's talking about it because she doesn't play in America, G.A. Shin.
Wow, great call. Great call.
Like, GA will get in this week and probably do no media unless Emma now goes and hassles her on the range tomorrow because she decides we're going to blow her up. But he's such a good player, is so suited to this week, is so good in the wind. It's just, and he's so fiercely competitive despite being the nicest human being you've ever met in your life. So it's just everything points to GA as my outsider.
Right.
Right.
Moving quickly along, we're going to cover off the other action in the world. The PGA Tour playoffs down to 50 players after last week in Memphis. We head for Castle Pines Golf Club in Colorado. Last time they actually played a PGA Tour event here, I think the only two players in the field that teed it up this week that were there last time, Jason Day and Adam Scott. So there you go.
Oh, wow. Trivia there fact. There you go.
And Rod, you're going to tell us a little bit about the BMW Championship.
BMW Championship, indeed. Second of the three playoff events, as you said. Jimmy, we're down to 50 this week, 30 moving on to Eastlake. Castle Pines Golf Club, it's an interesting one. Jack Nicklaus design from 1980. It's in Colorado. It's at elevation. So in honor of Logue, Jimmy, I did some research. I'm not sure if I got the elevation calculation right, but it's 1,950 metres above sea level, Castle Pines.
Is that one and a half Sahalis?
It's actually a bit over 10 Sahalis because Sahali is only at 180 metres above sea level. And that seems extreme to me, so I'm wondering whether I've got the right measurement. Is it the elevation change on the golf course or the elevation above sea level? I don't know. I think I've got it wrong. But anyway, ball's going to be going miles this week is the upshot of all that. There'll be lots of talk about that. Flies about 10% further. And as far as these guys already hit it, add 10%, you've got some serious numbers in place. There'll be a wow factor about it. The course doesn't get rave reviews from the architecture crowd, which is not a surprise. Jack Nicklaus often doesn't. Whether that's right or wrong, you can argue about that. The golf will be interesting, though. As you mentioned, Jimmy, we've had PGA Tour events here before. We know how the golf sort of looks. Has been a sort of the modified Stableford event generally at Castle Pines, so we haven't sort of seen stroke play there, but it'll be interesting. I would expect the scores will be pretty low. There's a lot to play for. Huge pot of money being divvied up at the end of next week over in Georgia. It's a bit of a repeat of last week, this week. Jimmy, am I just getting old? PGA, saying a few years of PGA. Look, it's all just a
bit. You are number one.
Yeah, okay, yeah, but that doesn't mean it's not an either or, is it, Jimmy? I can be old and right.
Correct.
Yeah, I don't know. It just feels all a bit samey. The PR's the same. The courses look the same. It's just all the problems we've been talking about for a long time, they just seem all in sharper focus this year with the turmoil of the last couple of years. So look, 50 of the very best golfers in the world going at it for a massive pot of money. It'll be interesting golf, but there's something lacking in golf at the top at the moment. I'm not sure what it is. I can't get too excited about this one, and I'm certainly not getting excited about the bloody handicap event next week. Enough out of me. Jimmy, back to you.
Well, why don't you tell us who's going to win, despite the fact that you clearly don't care and you're old and grumpy?
I'll tell you who's going to win, Ben Arne, and I'll tell you why Ben Arne's going to win, because the clock's ticking, and I said at the start of this year he was going to do something, and he's basically got this week to do it. So, Ben, get on with it.
I like Ben Arne. I'm a big Ben Arne fan, so I'm going to go with that.
He's a great personality. He's one of those tour players that if you do sort of find, he hasn't got the highest profile, but if you follow him on Twitter and a bit on social media, he's got a good sense of humour. He's a good fella.
Absolutely. Emma, have you got a pick for us in the BMW Championship?
I think he came very close, so I'm going to go with Victor Hovland after last week's performance. You know, he's trending back again, sort of. Came in the PGA champs, we're thinking he's back, and then he's sort of gone, but he's maybe back again. Obviously jumped loads up the standings, so I don't know. I think maybe that, you know, he came close. So I'm wondering whether that's maybe the push he needed to finally get it across the line this week.
He was definitely on my short list. I think he's finally recovered from having to spend time with Ewan Porter in Norway. That'll knock anyone back. So
Ewan might make the case I think that Victor, the turnaround is sort of following his visit to Norway, Jimmy. So take it easy.
No. I've spent enough time with Ewan and played golf in the days after and know exactly the effect it can have on you. So I liked Victor, but I'm going to go with, because someone has to tip him because he's probably going to win. And if he's not going to be, he's going to be in the top five, Scotty Scheffler, because he's on the table. So
Scheffler, really a bold call, Jimmy, after the quiet.
I know, I'm really stepping out on the edge here. Finally, this week, DP World Tour heads to Denmark for what is called the Danish Golf Championship, which there isn't much to find about, but I think is replacing what used to be the Made in Denmark / Made in Himmerland as a European tour stop in Denmark, because Made in Himmerland or Made in Denmark, whichever you want to call it, isn't on the schedule anymore. This is one Google search leads to this event and that event being linked. So not sure, but I think this is it. Any case, it is being played at Lubke Golf Resort. No one checked that pronunciation. Three nine hole loops, I should say, named Sand Sky Forest, all designed by Robert Trent Jones Jr. And at least the sand and sky combination looks quite remarkable. Like, there's a bit of link stuff here. There's a bit of everything. It's rated number 3 in Denmark when you put those two together. If only we had someone, Rod, who'd spent a lot of time in Denmark and played a lot of golf and could tell us all about this golf course.
Could occasionally turn up and offer something.
If he occasionally turned up. Anyway, never mind. The Forest Nine is obviously not that linksy sort of stuff. It's basically in a forest. So should be interesting from a golf course perspective this week. Rasmus Højgaard won last year's Made in Himmerland. So let's call him the defending champ. He's there alongside twin brother Nikolai. That's a big coup for the event. Having those two there playing in Denmark is massive. You've also got Thorbjørn Olesen, Thomas Bjorn. Also jumping out to me in the list of players on the field, invited Nick Watney.
Good on you. Hey, Nick.
Granted.
Why not? There will be a few PGA Tour players jumping over going to the DP World Tour in the coming weeks because they haven't gotten into the playoffs. They want to try and up their world ranking and all that sort of stuff. So there will be a little bit of that. But Nick Watney wasn't on my bingo list, I got to tell you. Anyway, got some Aussies as well. Jason Scrivener, David Michelucci, Hay Baron, Andrew Martin, Tom Power Horan. So let's make a pick here. And given you're geographically closest to Denmark, who do you like first?
Well, after not going for a British player in Scotland, I'm going to go for an English player in Denmark. And I'm going to go for Ross Fisher. It sounds a bit random, potentially. Feel like he's a bit of a contemporary of mine growing up, but someone I sort of always looked up to as a player. Obviously, he's been off the boil for quite a long time, appears every now and then. And actually, he seems to be playing sort of once a month, from what I can see, pretty much. But, you know, he's had a tied 12th when he played in July. He was tied 9th last week. Don't know. He's, you know, top 10. And after Andrew Johnson had, you know, a good turnaround and, you know, playing last week, I don't know, maybe it's inspiring some of them to play better. But, you know, it's a very much an outside pick. But I just thought, you know what, maybe. Trending in the right direction.
The odds are good out there, Emma. That's a good place to swim, out where the odds are nice and juicy, because every now and then you catch one and pays for all the rest of them.
Crazy things have happened.
having said, great player, Ross Fisher. I mean, not one of the greats of the game, but a really, really, really fine player. Made a living for a long time playing consistently well in Europe.
I was going to say, it's crazy how he just dropped off. You know, I think after last week, I had a look earlier, he's still ranked around 400 in the world. You just think that's... How is someone that talented ranked there? But, you know, as I say, you never know. I'm thinking potentially.
I like
it. Ross Fisher's got a son who's now getting to the age of being a very keen golfer. And so he's doing all that, going and taking him to play good golf courses and spending time. And those guys often get that little uptick because, number one, they don't want their kid to beat them
They're
that competitive. But they also go out and play more. And Ross Fisher is exactly the kind of an old open. They describe him as just a nice player. I think that's him all over. And Andrew Beef Johnson as well. That should have been in the highlights. I love watching Beef. That was
great. Absolutely.
That was
Rod, a pick from you in Denmark.
Well, as you could imagine, Jimmy, I was tempted by a Højgaard, particularly since both of them are in the field, and that's tended to be my habit. But it's too predictable, so I'm going for the next best thing to a Højgaard, and this week I'm going with Niklas Norgaard. So it'll be confusing watching them all on the boards with all the double ARD name endings, but go Niklas in Denmark.
Is he pronounced Norgaard, given Højgaard is Højgaard, I believe, in Danish?
Is it? Well, you're ahead of me. I didn't know. I would have thought it would have been the first part of the name was the problem. But you're saying the G-double-A-R-D, how do you pronounce that?
Højgaard. Oh, I think Højgaard. I can't remember. It's something like that.
Whatever it is, Norgaard probably finishes the same way in Danish, but in English we say Norgaard.
Yes, we do. I'm going to be predictable, and I was going pick a Højgaard, any Højgaard, and I'm going to go with Nikolaj because Rasmus won last year and they're twins, so they have to learn to share. So why not?
But who would know Jimmy?
Who would? Exactly right.
Do we know that that's what happened?
I've interviewed them both one after the other and couldn't tell. My little notes on my transcribing, I was like, okay, well, that one said that. So there you go.
That would be both fun and tiresome, wouldn't it? Being identical twins with some celebrity in a place like Denmark would be hilarious at times, but it would just be tiresome, you'd imagine, at other times.
Yeah, even having a brother or something where you'd just be called the wrong name all the time.
Exactly.
And then to magnify it with a twin is just ridiculous. Anyway, that will do us for episode 77 of Playing From the Tips. Emma, thank you so much for joining us. And now that you're a card-carrying tipster, how would you rate your own debut?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know. I think that's brothers, isn't it? We'll see after this week, because if the people I've predicted go really badly, then I'm just – well, it comes
right
back
in
to what I said. You know,
you're just as terrified. Bad as the rest of us.
I've been terrified all week to say who it was, because I was like, I'm going to kiss or death them. It's just unbelievable. Too much pressure.
Yeah, if you start winning, you don't get invited back. But as long as you don't make us look too bad, you can always get another go. Yeah.
Obviously, we reflected on Emma's performance. Rod, I don't think yours is worth reflecting on.
Two back off the lead and one off the rail, Jimmy.
Exactly. Now, but before we do go, not two back off the lead and one off the rail, I think you will agree with me, Rodney, that we're going to give a shout-out. Brendan James, former editor of Golf Australia magazine, has a new book out. It's called Great Golf Courses Australia. He wrote it. He photographed it. Rockpool Publishing put it all together. Fantastic book about all the best golf courses and golf around Australia. Father's Day coming up. Absolutely perfect. And just, well done, BJ. Get out and have a look at it and buy it.
If anybody would know the greatest golf courses in Australia, I don't know anyone who's played as many Australian golf courses and visited as many Australian golf courses as BJ, who can actually remember them as well.
Exactly. He's been literally everywhere and seen them all, played them all, photographed them all. So get out and have a look at that. And while we're plugging things, the latest issue, September, Golf Australia magazine is out. Xander Schauffele on the cover. Matt Cleary went and followed four shot specialists, including a mini golf champion and a long driver around Royal Pines and an Ambrose group for a story. That same man, Brendan James, went to the Australian Golf Club, and you can tell the review is it's in magnificent condition. Callum Hill spoke with Kazuma Kobori, and Paul Prendergast looks at the Brisbane Olympics, given we've just finished one, and Royal Queensland in 2032, and so much more. And, of course, follow all this action and so much more on golfaustralia.com.au. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back next week on Playing From the Tips.